to have as a Christian philosophy. And this will at first sound like this is a wrong statement, but give me a moment to think about this. Adam and Eve sinned. They fell prey to this temptation because they didn't really know God. Adam and Eve didn't really know him. It's like Paul was talking about earlier. It's not formulas. It's a personal relationship with God. And Adam and Eve didn't have a good personal relationship with God. And I know some of you are thinking, what are you saying? They were sinless. They walked and talked with God in the cool of the evening. But they fell prey to a lie that God wasn't good. God was holding something back on them, and they believed a talking snake more than they believed God. They didn't know how good God was. And again, I can give them a pass because you know what? They didn't know what you and I know. If somehow or another you could have told them God loved you so much that if you do sin, he's going to become a man someday. He's going to limit himself to a physical human body. And for 33 years, he's going to walk the earth being subject to heat, to hunger, to all of these things, to ridicule, rejection. He's going to become like you so that you can become like him. He will suffer. He will die. He will bear your debt. They didn't know those things. You and I know these things. You actually can know God better than Adam and Eve did. And I know what I'm saying sounds weird to some people because you think, oh, they were sinless. But they did not have the Word of God. And here's one of the main points I want to get across is that you can know God better through the Holy Spirit revealing him to you through the Word than you could if Jesus was here in his physical person walking and talking and doing things. The Word is the greatest way to know God and to have a relationship with him. And I know some of you thinking, man, I just can't believe this. But there's many things in Scripture that talk about this. Turn over to 2 Peter chapter 1 and let me show you some passages here. 2 Peter chapter 1. This is Peter writing, and he mentioned in this book that he was going to die soon. It wouldn't be long until he left them, and he had written these two books to them. And here in 2 Peter chapter 1 and in verse 12, he says, "Wherefore I will not be negligent to put you always in remembrance of these things, though you know them, and be established in the present truth. Yea, I think it meet, as long as I am in this tabernacle, to stir you up by putting you in remembrance, knowing that shortly I must put off this my tabernacle." This is old English for saying he was going to die soon, even as our Lord Jesus Christ hath showed me. "Moreover, I will endeavor that ye may be able, after my decease, to have these things always in remembrance. For we have not followed cunningly devised fables when we made known unto you the power and coming of our Lord Jesus Christ, but were eyewitnesses of his majesty. For he received from God the Father honor and glory when there came such a voice to him from the excellent glory, 'This is my beloved Son, in whom I am well pleased.' And this voice which came from heaven we heard when we were with him in the Holy Mount." You know what he's doing? He's saying, "I want you to recognize that what I've shared with you isn't just a story that I made up. This isn't a fable that I heard. I'm not repeating to you something that is just hearsay. I was there. I saw Jesus on the Mount of Transfiguration literally radiate light. Light came out of him. Moses saw the glory of God and it reflected on him, but Jesus, it came out of him. He radiated light. His garment became so white that you couldn't even look at it. There was a cloud, the Shekinah glory of God, that came over them, and there was an audible voice out of heaven that said, 'This is my beloved Son, hear him.' They saw Moses and Elijah, who had been dead for thousands of years, come and talk with Jesus and tell him what was going to happen after his crucifixion and what was going on. They saw all this. You know why he's saying this? Is to let you know that, hey, what I'm telling you is not something I made up. This isn't a story that I heard. I was there firsthand. I saw it. And he's trying to validate, get them to believe that, man, you can trust what I've said. You know, it'd be similar. You know, here we are holding a meeting, and praise God for those of you that came out on a Saturday morning. This is awesome. I don't know, we had 800, 900 people, whatever. And it's wonderful, but you know, if I'd have gone on television and said, I saw the glory of God, I heard an audible voice, an angel came and spoke to me, and I've got burning in my hand, and if I was giving some of these things, you couldn't have put all the people in here. But you let somebody come and say, man, God has spoken to me through his word, and they think, oh, another word, another message from the Bible, but they don't honor that as much. If you had two doors up here and one of them said some physical manifestation, light, glory, something like this, over here is the word, most people would take that door that says all these supernatural things. We don't honor and esteem the word so much. And so this is what Peter is doing, is saying, look, guys, I'm telling you something that I saw, I've experienced, I've seen these things. It's not something somebody else told me. But then he says this in the next verse, we have also a more sure word of prophecy. What can be more sure than seeing Jesus radiate light, the Father, and hearing his voice and seeing Moses and Elijah? What can get better than that? The next verse says, knowing this, that no prophet... And this will at first sound like this is a wrong statement, but give me a moment to think about this. Adam and Eve sinned. They fell prey to this temptation because they didn't really know God. Adam and Eve didn't really know him. It's like Paul was talking about earlier. It's not formulas. It's a personal relationship with God. And Adam and Eve didn't have a good personal relationship with God. And I know some of you are thinking, what are you saying? They were sinless. They walked and talked with God in the cool of the evening. But they fell prey to a lie that God wasn't good. God was holding something back on them, and they believed a talking snake more than they believed God. They didn't know how good God was. And again, I can give them a pass because you know what? They didn't know what you and I know. If somehow or another you could have told them, God loved you so much that if you do sin, he's going to become a man someday. He's going to limit himself to a physical human body. And for 33 years, he's going to walk the earth being subject to heat, to hunger, to all of these things, to ridicule, rejection. He's going to become like you so that you can become like him. He will suffer. He will die. He will bear your debt. They didn't know those things. You and I know these things. You actually can know God better than Adam and Eve did. And I know what I'm saying sounds weird to some people because you think, oh, they were sinless. But they did not have the Word of God. And here's one of the main points I want to get across is that you can know God better through the Holy Spirit revealing him to you through the Word than you could if Jesus was here in his physical person walking and talking and doing things. The Word is the greatest way to know God and to have a relationship with him. And I know some of you thinking, man, I just can't believe this. But there's many things in Scripture that talk about this. Turn over to 2 Peter chapter 1 and let me show you some passages here. 2 Peter chapter 1. This is Peter writing, and he mentioned in this book that he was going to die soon. It wouldn't be long until he left them, and he had written these two books to them. And here in 2 Peter chapter 1 and in verse 12, he says, wherefore I will not be negligent to put you always in remembrance of these things, though you know them, and be established in the present truth. Yea, I think it meet, as long as I am in this tabernacle, to stir you up by putting you in remembrance, knowing that shortly I must put off this my tabernacle. This is old English for saying he was going to die soon. even as our Lord Jesus Christ hath showed me. Moreover, I will endeavor that ye may be able, after my decease, to have these things always in remembrance. For we have not followed cunningly devised fables when we made known unto you the power and coming of our Lord Jesus Christ, but were eyewitnesses of his majesty. For he received from God the Father honor and glory when there came such a voice to him from the excellent glory. This is my beloved Son, in whom I am well pleased. And this voice which came from heaven, we heard where we were with him in the Holy Mount. You know what he's doing? He's saying, I want you to recognize that what I've shared with you isn't just a story that I made up. This isn't a fable that I heard. I'm not repeating to you something that is just hearsay. I was there. I saw Jesus on the Mount of Transfiguration literally radiate light. Light came out of him. Moses saw the glory of God and it reflected on him, but Jesus, it came out of him. He radiated light. His garment became so white that you couldn't even look at it. There was a cloud, the Shekinah glory of God, that came over them, and there was an audible voice out of heaven that said, this is my beloved Son, hear him. They saw Moses and Elijah, who had been dead for thousands of years, come and talk with Jesus and tell him what was going to happen after his crucifixion and what was going on. They saw all this. You know why he's saying this? Is to let you know that, hey, what I'm telling you is not something I made up. This isn't a story that I heard. I was there firsthand. I saw it. And he's trying to validate, get them to believe that, man, you can trust what I've said. You know, it'd be simple. You know, here we are holding a meeting, and praise God for those of you that came out on a Saturday morning. This is awesome. I don't know, we have 800, 900 people, whatever. And it's wonderful, but you know, if I'd have gone on television and said, I saw the glory of God, I heard an audible voice, an angel came and spoke to me, and I've got burning in my hand, and if I was giving some of these things, you couldn't have put all the people in here. But you let somebody come and say, man, God has spoken to me through his word, and they think, oh, another word message, another message from the Bible, and they don't honor that as much. If you had two doors up here and one of them said some physical manifestation, light, glory, something like this, over here is the word. Most people would take that door that says all these supernatural things. We don't honor and esteem the word so much. And so this is what Peter is doing, is saying, look, guys, I'm telling you something that I saw, I've experienced, I've seen these things. It's not something somebody else told me. But then he says this in the next verse, we have also a more sure word of prophecy. What could be more sure than seeing Jesus radiate light, the Father, and hearing his voice and seeing Moses and Elijah? What can get better than that? The next verse says, knowing this, that no prophecy...